Thank you. Thank you for your comments. I appreciate you. Appreciate you coming in tonight. Okay. Okay, anyone else in chambers that wanted to provide public comment? So if you want to come on up, just state your name and then 2 minutes. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. My name is Andrea, and I would like to read Psalm 118, 5 and 6, and then Psalms 117, 2. For I called upon the Lord in distress, and the Lord answered me and set me in a large place. The Lord is on my side, and I will not fear what God or what man can do to me. For his merciful kindness is great towards us, and the truth of the Lord endures forever. Praise be to the Lord. Now, this is the situation that happened tonight.
I'm not sure that that's coming through, but we also don't really care about the future. If you want to talk, so I'm people in the community who need to know how these programs are being managed. Okay, I will talk. I have the last year and a half. I have been doing programs and stuff. What prompted my child to come up is when my probation officer spoke to me when they asked me to not pray in public. If it offends people, don't pray on programs. These people have many times taken steps. Now I have over 100 hours of documentation. I started doing my own investigation, on these programs. And I'm here to tell you we've been discriminated in 549 Hope for praying. We've been discriminated, and I have videos. We've been discriminated repeatedly because the color of my skin. My children have watched these things. And like I said, I have hours and hours of documentation. I do. And if anybody wants to contact me, they can contact me at andreacase529@gmail.com. Because people need to hear, and people need to see this video. People need to see people. I got a video. I was told I could not go to 549 Hope. Because I recorded somebody in the thrift store as I was filling out a program for the Grace House, putting their hands on my dog. Now, when I say she apologized, I still have that in the video, and her reason was because she had a long day, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Okay? These are things that have happened, and you look like on your face, you don't want to hear. But people in the community need to hear what is going on in the program. Okay? They need to know that these children have slept in cars in the snow. I want to say thank you to the Missoula Briefing, and I want to say thank you to the Cavallaro for making a place for my children to rest and stuff, even when they don't know they didn't have to. I want to say thank you to those programs, and I want to say thank you to some law enforcement officers, too, Heavenly Father, that believed us when we were being attacked because of our religion. We had satanic worshipers think that we were going to sacrifice my children then. Now, I don't even know their names, but I know they got a ticket for trying to enter on the third time. Yeah, thank you. And so, what I'm saying is, people need to understand these programs. They need to be looked into. And the next thing, I'm also going to court for something that didn't happen. And I've got to go to the district attorney and my lawyer, admitting they have zero evidence. I mean, why are you wasting taxpayers' money? When I have physical evidence, these kids were taken to the hospital, observed, and questioned by social workers about a vehicle wreck. Let me tell you something. This is wasting taxpayers' money because there's zero proof that everybody that came against my family will be, everything will be brought to light. Everything. You know, like, I'm tagged because we pray for law enforcement in this community. So I'm also tagged. People are after my life because of it. I used to live a different life. I understand. I'm just a little graphic nature. But you know what? I serve the Lord, and I know the Lord now. And I've been knowing Him. And I see for the last year and a half of these programs, what I tell you, we've been discriminated. I've got time and time again people telling us, no, because we pray, we're too religious. I've got to be told, these programs need to be looked into. So again, AndreaK521@gmail.com. I also got a lawyer that was representing my family. Everything was dismissed in the middle of a 3-day trial. Why, like my son said, they were taken from me praying in tongues in my vehicle. Okay? See, I was in my vehicle.
too, though, so I wanted to say thanks to them. It's over 20 at this point. But
thank you.
I gave that information to you to follow up on these two. That helps.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other public comment from anyone else in chambers that wants to provide public comment on items not on the agenda? And I'll look online in case there's any raised hands. I'm not seeing any, so if we can go to the city clerk to go through item number 4, announcing the committee meetings and committees' agenda.
Can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. So, I'm going to announce the City Council's committee meetings just for folks who are watching us this evening. Information, next week, City Council will not be meeting. Next week, on the 24th of April, City Council will be meeting in regular session. And just a reminder to all of you out there who have administrative professionals in your life, April 26th is Administrative Professionals Day. Remember those important people. Let's talk about the committee schedule. So, all of the City Council committees are being held on April 19th. We're going to try to give our administrative professionals a day off next week, Wednesday. Committees will meet out on the 19th with Climate Conservation and Parks Committee. I think my screen just a little bit bigger. Oops, folks who are looking can follow along over there. There we go. So Climate Conservation and Parks Committee will meet this coming Wednesday on the 19th from 10 a.m. to 10:25. They'll be looking at two things. One is an interlocal agreement for a joint city-county energy efficiency rebate, as well as the East Paris Park site restoration contract. That's for a construction contract. Housing, Redevelopment, and Community Programs Committee will also meet this coming Wednesday from 10:40 to 11:20 in the morning. They'll be taking up the funding recommendations for the Unified Application Program year for 2023. And the Public Works and Mobility Committee will meet on the 19th from 11:35 to 11:50. And they'll be taking up a professional services agreement with IMEG, a local engineering firm here in town, for the design of the South 4th Street Water Main Replacement Project. I also do want to mention that it is potential that we'll have a quorum of City Council attending a screening next week, Wednesday. It's being held from 9 o'clock, 1 o'clock, in City Council chambers. And it is part of the city's JEDI initiative, Justice, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. And the title of the training is called Be Culture. And I know a lot of folks in the community have participated. And that was all, council members. We're going to continue just continuing work in that area with the council. That's our schedule this week.
Great. Thank you, Marty. Next is our consent agenda. Items on the consent agenda were approved in city council committees to be placed on the consent agenda to save time at council meetings by voting on them as a package. So the state will have a list of the citizens watching on the council on the consent agenda. We'll invite community comment on these items before we vote. To you, Marty, for the consent agenda. Marty, we can't hear you.
Oh, Jeremy, I've been talking at Blue Street. So sorry. I'm sharing my screen so folks at home can follow along with me. And tonight's consent agenda has 9 items. The first is to approve the house table. That is the city's bills. And this week they are in the amount of $972,668.11 for Tech Center Day and tomorrow, April 18th of 2023. I think there's somebody in our audience. Can you check your microphone and see if you might need to mute? We're getting a little bit of iron. Item number two is to adopt a resolution authorizing the execution and delivery of various property schedules with respect to the master tax exempt installment purchase agreement with U.S. Bank for Government Leasing and Finance Incorporated for financing of various items of capital and equipment and other matters in connection therewith. Okay, I'm going to check and see.
Sure, whether your hand is raised and you're able to hear the consent agenda?
I'm able to hear, but I'm hearing two people, so I just wanted to flag that.
All right, well, turn your mic on.
Or at least ambient noise.
Okay. All right, well, sorry, Marty.
Sorry, I was hearing the same thing and I'm just wondering how that would be affecting the kind of virtual audience for maybe over here. Number three is to confirm the mayor's reappointment of J.R. Casillas to the Parking Commission for a term that begins May 1st of 2023, expires on April 30th of 2027. Number four is to approve the Energy and Climate Team Bylaws version dated March 15th of 2023, on the Energy and Climate Team and make them effective immediately. Number five is to approve and authorize the mayor to sign a contract with Missoula County to receive funds not to exceed $130,000 and provide services outlined in the contract. When you wrote this motion, did not mention that the type of contract that is itself. For the mental health mill funds for the city's and county's mobile support team. Number five is the first reading and preliminary adoption of an ordinance. Folks, tonight, City Council is setting a public hearing on May 8th of 2023, preliminarily adopting an ordinance to rezone. It says the subject property and the title, it says where it is. So this is a rezoning proposal for the corner of Inez and Idaho Street. It says that right afterwards, too. Rezone subject property located at the corner of Idaho Street and Inez Street. And legally described as lots 4 through 12 in Block 7 of the Eddy Edition, located in Section 21, Township 13 North, Range 19 West, Prince Meridian, Montana, from R20. Which is a residential 20 zoning district in the city, to B2-2, which is a community business zoning district. And this is always some of the findings of fact that includes in the staff report. And council's been asked to refer this item to the Land Use and Planning Committee presentation, discussion, and motion on May 10th of 2023. So that will be post hearing, the Land Use and Planning Committee will take that item. Number seven is first reading and preliminary adoption of an ordinance. So, City Council tonight is setting a public hearing on May 8th of 2023 and preliminarily adopting an ordinance rezoning a subject property located at the southeast corner of Southwest Stevens Avenue and Northview Drive. And it's legally described in Exhibit B, which is part of the ordinance, which is attached to tonight's agenda. I'll show the picture, it's there. And the proposal is zoned from R5.4 residential, 5.4, and E1-1 neighborhood business, DE-C-2 design excellence overlay corridor typology 2 to B2-1 community business, DE-C-2 design excellence overlay corridor typology 2. We refer this item to the Land Use and Planning Committee for presentation on May 10th. I assume that that will also include some discussion and recommendations from the committee for the council for final action, since that is a post public hearing item. If somebody wouldn't mind letting the person in the meeting who just showed up and is waiting in the lobby, I'd appreciate it. And number 8 is to adopt a resolution of intention to annex and incorporate within the boundaries of the city of Missoula one certain parcel of land described as a portion of Tract 3, a certificate of survey number 6355, located in the northwest quarter of Section 13, Township 12, North Range 20, West Principal Meridian, Montana. And I'm just trying to read ahead here to see if it says in English where it is. It does in the title. So, in the title of the assignment, it mentions that this is property that's addressed as 6991 Alicia Drive. And its legal description is described in the staff report and shown in Exhibits A and B, allowing the property to remain zoned Miller Creek View Addition Plan Unit Development based on the findings of fact and the staff report, subject to recommended conditions of annexation approval, and set a public hearing for May 1st of 2023 and refer this item to the Land Use Planning Committee for May 3rd. So the proposal is for folks who are watching is for the council to announce and adopt this resolution of intention to annex this property. And it is the city's practice and policy to apply zoning to that land so it doesn't come in unzoned upon annexation. And so that is the nature of the proposal that I just read in a little bit more English. And then number 9 is to approve a waiver to Missoula Municipal Code Chapter 9.30 entitled Noise Control Permit Relief and Specified Levels during a project with LHC Incorporated and the Montana Department of Transportation. They're going to be completing a project to mill and fill, chip seal, sign, and mark the pavement on West Broadway and Old Highway 10 beginning in early May.
We do have people from NDC here, I believe, in the audience to answer any questions on item number 5.9. Do you have folks here on that one? No? Okay. Let's try to get you to ask someone. Ms. West, did you have a question or comment? Okay. I'm having technological difficulties over here. It says my camera's on, but my camera's not on. But I just had a quick comment on item 5.5. I think there was some media coverage which made it sound like additional mental health funds were going to be levied, and that is not the case. These are just existing, coming out of existing levy. There is no increase in taxes that is levied against the funds. Thank you. Yeah, that's a good question. We have a question about mental health. No one is going to be counting that. We're going to pitch for its mobile support team. And Sarah Williams, your hand is raised. Are you here? You should be able to speak. Are you here in the main room, NDT item?
Yeah, I was
like
two of us here from NDT if there's any questions.
Okay, thanks. So, counselors, if anybody do have a question on the last item, the noise control, the waiver to so that they can get a project funded. Anyone have questions? Because we have someone from NDC here. All right, I'm not seeing any raised hands. Anything else from council? Then we'll go ahead and have a roll call vote, please, on the consent agenda.
Okay, on the consent agenda, items 139, Anderson. Sarah?
Yes.
Carlino?
Yes.
Santos?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Jordan?
Yes.
Bridget? Savage?
Yes.
Cheryl?
Yes.
Jessica?
Yes.
West?
Yes.
Anything you'd like to change your vote? That is 12
eyes, and it passes. Thank you. And thanks to the folks that I zooming in some of the minutes. We all do. Consent agenda. So thanks so much. All right, next we have comments from city staff, city agencies, community forum, neighborhood councils, but we have nothing under that category tonight. After that, we have three proclamations that I'll go through in the order that they were listed. The first is a National Small Business Week proclamation that I'll read. Whereas America's strongest economic growth in almost 40 years has been driven by the resilience of our small businesses that, despite a worldwide pandemic, continue to pioneer innovative solutions to our country's greatest challenges and create opportunities for families and workers. And whereas small businesses remain the heartbeat of our communities and the American economy, employing more than half of our nation's workers, inventing and innovating to launch new technologies and create new American-led industries, enriching our main streets, making parts and products in America to fuel our supply chains and building our nation's infrastructure. And whereas when we support small businesses, jobs are created and local communities preserve their unique culture. And whereas the President of the United States has proclaimed National Small Business Week every year since 1963, to highlight the programs and services available to entrepreneurs through the U.S. Small Business Administration and other government agencies. And whereas the City of Missoula supports and joins in this national effort to recognize the contribution of small businesses to the American economy and their importance to ensuring that local communities remain as vital tomorrow as they come today. And therefore, under the U.S. Mayor of the City of Missoula and the State of Montana, hereby recognize the week of April 30th and 26th, 2023, as National Small Business Week. Is there anyone here who wanted to speak to this proclamation? Seeing none, we will go on. The next proclamation is the Sexual Assault Action Month. So this is between Missoula County, the City of Missoula, the University of Montana, and the Associated Students of the University of Montana. Whereas Sexual Assault Action Month calls attention to the fact that sexual violence is widespread and has public health and safety implications for the city and county of Missoula and beyond. And whereas rape, sexual assault, and sexual harassment harm our community and our friends and our families, studies show 1 in 6 women and 1 in 33 men experienced completed or attempted rape, 1 in 9 girls and 1 in 53 boys experienced child sexual abuse at the hands of an adult, and 13% of all college students experienced rape or sexual assault through physical force, violence, or incapacitation, and that's graduate and undergraduate students. And whereas people of color, especially Native American women, experience violence, unwanted sexual contact, or abuse at a much higher rate than other groups, and whereas statistics can tell us how many people are harmed, but talking to a survivor reveals the true impact of this violence, loss of safety and trust, and sometimes even a loss of hope. And whereas the goal of this month is not merely awareness, but prevention of sexual harassment, abuse, and assault. And whereas prevention means stopping sexual violence before it happens, or changing norms that allow it to exist in the first place, ranging from attitudes, values, and behaviors, to laws, institutions, and social norms. And whereas prevention is everyone's job, if all of us can help create safe environments by intervening to stop behavior, promoting healthy attitudes and relationships, and believing survivors and connecting them to resources. And whereas we strongly support the efforts of national, state, and local sexual assault prevention and response programs and internet efforts to create safe and healthy communities. And now, therefore, we, Jordan Hess, Mayor of the City of Missoula, Josh Slotman, Wayne Rivero, and Dave Stroman, the Missoula County Commissioners, Seth Bader, President of the University of Montana, and Elizabeth Bowles, President of the Associated Students of the University of Montana, we hereby join the Student Advocacy Resource Center of the University of Montana, YWCA of Missoula, Project Beacon of All Nations Health Center, First Step at Providence St. Patrick Hospital, the Nuclear Move Project for the Missoula City County Health Department, law enforcement agencies, including the Missoula Police Department, Missoula County Sheriff's Office, and the UN Police Department, the Missoula County Community Justice Department, the Special Victims Unit of the Missoula County Attorney's Office, the City Attorney's Office, and communities across the country in playing an active role to prevent sexual violence, along with the United States government and the state of Montana. We do hereby proclaim April 2023 as Sexual Assault Action Month in the city of Missoula and Missoula County. And if anyone wants to provide comment on that, Please come on and just state your name.
Thank you. My name is Debbie Jenkins. I'm actually from Princeton, and okay, I am the regional representative for Jane Gilmore. Jane Gilmore is an organization that I brought to Montana in 2017 after my sexual assault in McCormick Park in 2015. I was desperately lost. While the YWCA CDA, First Steps, CERC, and Professional Counselor were all invaluable to me, I still needed more. I needed to find a community of survivors who wanted to proactively move out of their trauma and work to make a difference for the future of sexual assault survivors. Because of the treatment that I was subjected to at the hands of the defense team and ultimately the Supreme Court, I wanted to make sure to make a difference by shining a light on this experience and what needs to be done better. Missoula and Montana as a whole must be better. Jane Doe Memorial empowers survivors to find their voice, advance their healing, and educate the public on the proper treatment of victims of sexual assault, not only by first responders in the judicial system, but by the community as well. We have a clear vision that matches what this proclamation states. We stand in agreement and are working for the prevention of sexual assault. Since bringing Jane Doe Memorial to Montana, I've trained 10 survivors to help me in this quest and support each other like no other can. It's a known fact that most of us in this arena are survivors trying to make a difference to those who come behind us. This trauma-informed education helps individuals gain a deeper understanding of the complexities of these types of crimes, placing emphasis on ways in which to prevent them, how to best support survivors, and how to stop re-victimization. This personal approach has been effective in engaging individuals in the community, in the legislature, businesses, corporations, and organizations to work together in order to create real and meaningful change. One of our greatest successes comes from the survivors of sexual crimes who have joined our gender memorial outreach team. Our team is largely volunteer-based and consists of a wide range of different races, genders, ethnicities, and socioeconomic status. These amazing volunteers have become part of our gender memorial family of survivors and are empowered to help others while advancing their own healing. Together, we are building a local, vibrant, invisible survivor community. If you walk or drive down Hilton's Avenue, you will notice tear-colored mesh ribbons with a QR code on them. If you scan the code, it will take you to the Jane Doe Memorial website, and you can learn a lot more. Also, if you visit Join Coffee, you will see our Jane Doe Memorial coffee slips being used to spread awareness and support this month. I've been told by a former state senator that sexual assault victims are not the experts. I beg to differ. We are the ones who have had to live with what others have done to us against our will, some of us at a very young age. I myself have had 48 years of experience living with the stigma. At the age of 56, I think that qualifies me as an expert on the subject. However, I have had extensive experience and training from organizations such as YWCA, the Lifeguard Group, the National Credentialing Program, State of Montana, Victim Impact Panel, EVALU, many training seminars that I have attended and helped facilitate across the state, SAUCI, National Conference, Research and Studies, Appropriate Court Conference, major conferences that I have spoken at as well as universities that I have spoken at on the subject matter. I am a RAIN speaker and an author, but in all truthfulness, none of us with members to me, as much as for all of you to realize that Jane Doe Memorial is a valid resource right here in your midst that should be tapped into. I come here tonight to offer Jane Doe Memorial once again to Missoula, Montana, and the Northwest region as a viable resource that you can and should take advantage of. I have some rap cards with me if anyone is interested, and I encourage you to read a little bit more about some of the programs that we offer. They are not exhaustive, but rather a snapshot of what we can offer. Thank you. And thank you, Kathy.
Thank you so much for the information. And if you do have some friends, if you just want to leave it there, it's not good. Thank you so much. Okay, we're going to the last proclamation tonight. which is for Earth Day. This is between Missoula County and the city of Missoula, whereas the climate crisis is human-induced and adversely impacting an overwhelming majority of humans and natural systems locally and across the globe, and whereas the most vulnerable people and systems are disproportionately affected by the climate crisis, which poses extraordinary challenges, such as public health emergencies, natural disasters, food and water shortages, and economic disruption, and whereas it is understood that the citizens of every community must step forward and take action to combat the aforementioned global challenges. And whereas the city of Missoula and Missoula County have been engaged in environmental stewardship and climate action-related commitments, projects, work, and planning for many years, including joint commitments to climate resilience and achieving 100% clean electricity for the Missoula urban area by 2030. And whereas the city of Missoula and Missoula County have aligned our local efforts with the principles of the Paris Climate Agreement, and join public and private partners in Missoula and across the globe in advancing meaningful climate action in alignment with the goals of this agreement. Now, therefore, we, the Missoula Board of County Commissioners and the City of Missoula and the State of Montana, jointly declare April 22, 2023 as Earth Day and call on our communities, including all residents, businesses, and institutions, to continue engaging in the meaningful climate action that is necessary for the Earth Day, stated this 22nd day of April. Anyone want to comment on that proclamation? Okay. All right. Thursday, April 22nd. All right, then we're going to go on with our agenda. We have no items under final consideration. We do have one public hearing tonight, and we will be voting on it. Yes, we will take this item up for final consideration this same evening because it is like that. So that is on item 9.1, referral and staff report on the phase development review for relation trials. I believe we have Cassie supplied here. Staff to present on that. Good evening, Cassie.
Hello. Can you see my slides?
Yes.
So I'm Cassie Kippard, I'm planning supervisor at Community Planning Development and Innovation. Today, I'm presenting a staff report on the phase development review for Riverfront Trail Subdivision Phase 1A. I'll begin with background on the project, then discuss the parameters for a phase development review, and then go through staff's recommended amendments to findings of fact and conclusions of law. The Riverfront Trail Subdivision is located at 6525 Lower Mill Creek Road near Jeanette Clayton Elementary School. The subdivision was granted preliminary plat approval on December 12, 2022, by City Council with 4 phases. The subdivision will contain 176 lots on 32.73 acres and is zoned RT5.4 residential with the neighborhood, with Riverfront Trails neighborhood character overlay. The subdivision includes a large park along the Bitter River zoned OP2 open and resource land. This phase development review is for phase 1A, shown here in green. Phase 1A includes two lots on approximately 12.36 acres. Phase 1A also includes two city park parcels and one HOA common area parcel on approximately 43.6 acres. Access to the park parcels is included with this phase. Road improvements in this phase include Lower Miller Creek Road, the roundabout at the intersection of Lower Miller Creek Road and Old Bitter Road, as well as the installation of portions of Grego Lane, Golden Root Road, and Riverfront Place. Please note the phase of development is shown on the exhibit for reference. Here is the draft final plot for phase 1A. You can see the features I just mentioned on the last slide, as well as trail road and stormwater easements required for this phase. Phase development review is mandated by state law and requires City Council to hold a public hearing and conduct a review prior to the applicant's ability to submit for final plot review. In this review, the goal is to determine if there are any changed subdivision primary review criteria impacts or new information which results in significant adverse impacts that were not known at the time of preliminary plot approval. If these circumstances do exist, the governing body is able to apply any conditions of approval or existing conditions. They may also erect findings of fact and conclusions of law or propose new ones. Council may choose to approve the phase development review with some or all of these recommendations, add new conditions based on new information, or choose to approve the phase development review with the original findings of fact and conditions of approval from the preliminary plat approval. Phase development review cannot be denied. After phase development review, the applicant may submit for final plat approval, which ensures their submittal meets the conditions that result from the phase development review process. Change primary review criteria and your information may become more likely as time passes between the preliminary plat approval and phase development review. Considering the preliminary plat for the subdivision was just approved last December, there hasn't been much chance for changes to occur. The city's subdivision regulations include review of the following impacts from a proposed subdivision derived from the Montana Subdivision and Plat Act. These are categories to appoint the staff report. The staff recommended comments all relate to city and council local services. There are two new pieces of information, which I'll cover in more detail on the following slides. First piece of new information is an updated traffic impact study, which made a section of Lower Mountain Creek Road as a bigger road. The subject is a minor adjustment approved by staff. The applicant is not proposing any changes to the approved phasing plan. Staff sent a request for agency comment on March 20th. It said it's just that the public hearing requested public comment on March 22nd to the adjacent property owners. No concerns were expressed from agency staff regarding change impacts, and staff had received one public comment. With the preliminary plat, City Council imposed a condition of approval requiring an updated traffic impact study for the intersection of Lower Mountain Creek Road and Old Bitter Road. This is condition of approval number 5, and this is part of the state condition of approval that requires the developer to install a capable roundabout. With the phase development review submittal, the applicant completed the updated study for the intersection. City engineering reviewed and approved the study. In the portion of condition number 5, requiring an updated study is now met. Staff recommends adding a finding of fact that covers this information shown here. Staff do not recommend any changes to conditions of approval. Public Works and Mobility will be coming forward with the development agreement proposal for installation of the roundabout in the next few months. The development agreement is separate from this request for phase development review. Staff approved a minor adjustment at the end of February. Shown here is the approved preliminary plat. You can see that the roundabout at the intersection of Lower Mountain Creek Road and Old Bitter Road was planned to be located partially on the Riverfront Trails subdivision property and largely on adjacent property. This would have required obtaining more right-of-way from adjacent properties. Also note here that Drago Lane is curved. There was a pedestrian easement proposed on Lot 2 as well. The draft final plot and the application packet accounts for the minor adjustment. You can see that the shape of Lot 2 has been modified slightly to allow the majority of the roundabout to be located on the subdivision property. This allows the applicant to move forward with installation of the roundabout so they can work to the subdivision condition of the In order to create more space for the roundabout, Drago Lane was straightened out. Pedestrian easement was also removed. The staff determined that pedestrian easement did not provide substantial connectivity benefits, considering it was only about 25 feet from the public sidewalk. Lot 1 decreased in size, and Lot 2 increased in size. Overall, there was a net loss in the lot area. Staff recommends any finding of fact under transportation elements that addresses the minor adjustment. Finding of fact number 13 states the adjustment was approved, and the purpose was to place the majority of the roundabout on the subdivision property. Staff recommends any finding of fact under transportation elements, further describing the impacts of the minor adjustment. Finding of fact number 14 describes the changes in lot size, the straightening out Drago Lane, and removal of the pedestrian easement on Lot 2. In the preliminary plat approval letter, there was a separate section describing the urban local streets in the subdivision, which includes Drago Lane. Staff recommended new finding of fact under this section to describe the change in alignment for Drago Lane. Straightening out Drago Lane does not change the type of facility or the approved width of the facility for the road. Another section of the approval letter focused specifically on non-motorized facilities. Staff recommended new finding of fact to describe the elimination of the pedestrian utility easement approved with the minor adjustment. And under transportation elements, any costs on local services section, the approval letter contains conclusions of law related to the findings of fact. Staff recommends three new conclusions of law to summarize the new information provided for the space development review. Recommended conclusion of law number three summarizes the minor adjustment and states amendments to conditions of approval are not proposed. Recommended conclusion of law number four covers the updated traffic impact study. It also states amendments to conditions of approval are not proposed. And conclusion of law number five states the findings of fact in the approval letter are still valid if the city council adopts the amendments to the findings of fact. Staff's recommended motion is for approval of the phase development review of Riverfront Trail Subdivision Phase 1A, located on Illinois Creek Road, based on the findings of fact and conclusions of law and staff report, and subject to conditions of preliminary plat approval dated December 12, 2022. Thank you. Here for questions and the applicant to the chair as well.
Okay, first of all, before we go to business, any public comments on this item before the questions? So, comments to the podium? Seeing no public comments. Questions from council? Thanks so much, staff. Appreciate this. Is there, when, you know, for those folks who didn't go and reread the new traffic study, can you basically kind of distill down if there was any major changes? I know it's something that we talked about in December, as that the traffic study that originally was in the packet was conducted in, you know, during the pandemic, and the new one was hopefully just to kind of take into consideration normal, and I put in quotes for the example of normal, what new normal is, traffic patterns, now that we are pretty much out of any sort of lockdown, work from home sort of things.
Yeah, I also see Troy Monroe with engineering and the attending of this, if he could help me out with that question.
The updated GIS basically dove into the details of the different phases, plan times, and what the roundabout necessary. So it's a quick two-page GIS. I don't believe that they had any additional study to it. Mostly just based on what percentage of future traffic would be contributing to the subdivision and full build-out. So I took into account growth rates on the rest of the Northern Creek area, and then looked at it because at the full build-out date, 2027.
So that means that the roundabout, the full build-out for this will be completed by 2027, so that means all of the various phases of the subdivision, and at what point is the roundabout scheduled to go?
The roundabout installation is required prior to final plat for phase 1A. It means they need to install it before they establish these part parcels in these two blocks, so before anything gets planted here.
Thank you for distilling that into another planner speak.
No problem.
Okay. Great. And then Troy just said, 2027 is the plan. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, sorry. So, the business is not in the file. When will folks be able to speak? There's been a lot of questions in the community around what is being proposed in the block. Is public interreligious assembly? And, you know, we've been
implementation in December saw what the kind of signs and schematics were for the senior living facility, as well as people were able to wrap their head around that. So what are the next phases for public ability to see an online and track this process as it continues to get that?
So after the stage six development review, so developers to meet the conditions of approval, then at that point they'll be able to file for the special class, actually establish the sidewalk. Once that's complete, they can apply for building permits, which is the first time we have to see it applied. There's not a public review process for building permits, so that's submitted to the public application.
Thank you so much. I apologize, I have been having some technical issues that are distracting me at this point. Kathy, can you just remind me what one and what two of our goals before? I know you just kind of talked about a little bit, but can you avoid it? And what are the years that you face?
Yeah, so the subdivision project,
Anderson.
Yes.
Would you like to change your vote? That is 12 ayes and it passes.
Thank you so much. We have nothing under committee reports, under new business. Jessica, are you here to provide a legislative update?
Yes, I am.
Evening. That is what's going on in the last few weeks.
I just put it to the extent that the public is so clear and the executive session. I'm so upset to be good special that Saturday, the 6th, with the legislative. Thank you.
No questions. We have no other new business. I will pass some communications from the mayor, and I will go to general comments from city council members, and I'm just going to go around the horse tree. So let's start with Ms. Farmer.
Thanks, Dr. Steve.
Mr. Nugent?
Oh, thanks.
Ms. Jordan? Oh, thanks, thanks. Mr. Clonson?
Yes, I'd like to say something about the assault. That is a complicated problem. I think a lot of it, if we think about this, it all starts at home. Raising our children. So we have to ask ourselves, what do we see? And that's what comes out a little bit later on. So I think getting to have some attention to how we raise our children and being a better example. Can you see it all? Thank you.
And the state of the Earth Day proclamation, and I just wanted to let people know that many neighborhoods are having cleanups for next year. Which all neighborhoods are participating, but I know there is one happening on the north side, west side, meeting places at the school and the north side park later this month. And I believe it's April 29th at 1 a.m. So if you have questions, I think you can check out the neighborhood website that the city has, and see if you're in the neighborhood is also participating. Thank you. Thank you. Ms. West, I think you may be upcoming. The Lord's Faith one is this weekend, but check the city website. Also, this is the season for leaf pickup. You can check, which is different than leaf speaking. There's two different maps and schedules on the city's website. But take advantage and look at that and get your stuff to the curbs. And it's just leaves and nothing else. But thanks to the city for doing that, and Premier Hensel and his team and all the great work they're doing. We appreciate all of them. And just everyone will have an opportunity to get to do a little leaf picking. So, great meeting. Thanks so much. So, there's leaf pickup and street sweep. Okay, we're all good. Okay, here's the speaker.
Thank you, Jen. I have a couple quick things I wanted to say. I want to echo Heidi. The Franklin to the Fort cleanup is the 29th of this month, April 29th. And there will be a meeting at Franklin Park at 11 a.m. I'll go to a few p.m. and I'll bring back some desks. Other stuff, photos, and masks that may or may not be provided. I think that they're going to be provided, but I guess I should check that before I announce that on the record. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me or to the website on the city website, California Neighborhood Councils. I also wanted to thank the students for coming for the Essential Roles Call Awareness Month. It's a really hard subject, and unfortunately, it's really prevalent in our communities. Whenever somebody has resources and a story that they share to help others, I really appreciate it. So thank you. be careful. It was sunny outside, so I was going outside, and I just had to take a kiss off of my friend. So be careful and check people for tips.
We have an administratively approved agreement report to be attached if anyone wants to look at that. We have no other items of business, so thank you for your service, and we will stand adjourned.